Test.
Cool, right here. One more, here we go.
If everyone could please head to their seats, we're going to start in about 5 minutes.
Thank you.
Welcome to the first annual Startup Chicago 2019 Pitch Showcase. We've got an awesome evening of innovation planned for everybody, and we're so excited that you've all chosen to participate. So I'm really excited to announce our MC for tonight's event. He is the CEO and founder of Q Brand Communications, the CTO of Q Lab, CPG Committee Chair of Keiretsu of the Midwest, and his recent appearances include NBC, Cranes, and Curated Chicago. Please join us in welcoming this evening's MC, Ross Vangelis.
Any props to Coke. So. All right. So, greetings everyone. As you guys know, we're streaming live on Facebook and YouTube today, so that's kind of exciting. Wanted to kind of start off with, let's see here, I guess, this slide. That's me. Take it in. I'm going to move on now. So why Startup Chicago? And I got to talk to a few of our entrepreneurs here tonight, but we kind of have three objectives. We want this to be an annual event, and one of the first things we wanted to do, and I think everybody in this room really understands this, is promote the massive untapped power of Chicago's entrepreneur community and kind of start stitching it together, because there's so much opportunity here, right? We've got the West Coast heavily saturated, full of VC. We want some of that money. We want some of our entrepreneurs to get recognition and get noticed, and, right? All entrepreneurs agree with that. So that's one of the first reasons. Our vision is, again, to kind of unite VCs, entrepreneurs, incubators, and really start an ecosystem here so that we can really continue to thrive and grow. And then lastly, we just want to plain beat the West Coast. All right. So, I gotta remember to click this. So, today's schedule, everybody has it, so I'm gonna kind of be high level, but we're gonna have five presenters. They each have 10 minutes. They will then be able to do Q&A with our judging panel. And you're gonna see a real range and stage, different stages of startups here. So everything from a little bit early, really have a great premise, all the way to kind of in market, kind of doing it. And the judges have been informed to vote with their hearts and their minds. So everybody's got a truly fair shake here to see who wins. So that's really exciting. Our startup competition is going to be communicated massively on September 3rd. And our startup package includes a diagnostic from the lab. We're going to kind of take them through what we call our lab lenses. So kind of, you know, how are we disrupting? How are we competing? How will we grow? And how will we acquire? So that good old engage and grow and take share. So. We'll be putting you guys through that, the winner. Then we go to activation, so whatever the diagnostic kind of gives us an indicator that we need to accelerate, we're going to focus on that, grow it. And then lastly, some ongoing coaching. In addition to that, I'm happy to announce that due to our good PR friends sitting in the back there, if they want to wave, they have helped us procure two awesome things for a media tour. So the winner will be going to NBC Chicago, taping a TV excerpt, and then we'll also be hitting CBS Radio Live with us for a live broadcast. So that's really exciting. So judging criteria, basically the judges are gonna really kind of be looking, well, first of all, I wanna start off with, the judges know this, you two guys came in a little bit late, so I'm gonna tell you, this isn't Shark Tank, right? We're not gonna be like, hey, your product's, you know, we're not like that, right? We support the entrepreneurs in the room, They are here and exposing themselves and their dreams. We absolutely support that 100%. The judges have rating cards. You can see kind of how that works up there. They're going to be actively tallying, and at the end of the evening, they will tally. They will place a 1, 2, and 3 against who their selections are, and they will be handed in, and we will do that. And again, it'll be announced on September 3rd. All right. Judges, look at how beautiful these people are. Can you guys stand up and acknowledge the group and then just give a little bit about your name and your company and pass it on.
Okay. Hi, I'm Julie Beck. I'm with Q Lab. I'm the strategic sales advisor and I'm really excited to be here. So thank you. Woo-hoo.
Hi, I'm Molly Soad. I'm the editor-in-chief of the American Marketing Association.
Hi everyone, Jackson Jin. My title there is a little out of date, but I was at Chicago Ventures, recently took an operating role as the interim CFO of a company called Cameo, which is a local startup. You can pay celebrities to give you a personalized video shout out. So check it out afterwards, cameo.com.
Shout out.
I still have to respond to his email. My name is Gabe Ramirez. I do the morning show at B96 here in Chicago. I'm a local, born and raised here. I love ideas, love creativity, so I'm excited to be here and see what's going to happen today.
Rachel Stillman. I'm on the investment team at Seven Wire Ventures. We are a digital health consumer-focused venture firm, so excited to be looking at some non-healthcare companies today.
So Gabrielle, how would you rate my Gabriel, how would you rate my voice right now?
Check your voice a little louder.
Oh, darn it. All right, so we're gonna quickly kind of go through this. So who's Q Lab? Basically, take it through this really quickly. We're a new breed of accelerator. Basically, the concept that we have is to fuse a consultancy and kind of integrate services for VCs and to work with VCs, but with startups. So a lot of times you guys are given funding, you're looking for funding, but how do you put together how do we hit the right retail channel? How do we put together a marketing plan? What should our price point be and our entry point? So what we've done is we've organized that, put it through a 4-week process to kind of accelerate you guys and then kind of activate as needed with a full service agency, but it's an accelerator model. So the space right now for all you guys is still amazing, venture and private equity, everything that's going on. So we're really excited at what we can do with that model. Some of our experience metrics, we've worked, this is kind of leaning into our agency space, but over 100 brands, 20 industries, 13 countries, 10 M&A exits, and 40 plus awards. You can see some of the people we've worked with. And I'm gonna play a video now, hopefully. Yay. Is it gonna sound?
An accelerator should enable transformation. That accelerator is QLab. We partner with disruptive companies within high growth markets, providing the marketing services, advising, and investment opportunities needed to accelerate, scale, and grow business. Our approach provides a nurturing environment of collaboration and mentorship. This gives startups access to a multitude of resources and mentoring from industry visionaries and business experts, as well as networking events to help boost exposure. Our programs, platforms, and advisors ensure businesses reach their true potential at an accelerated pace. QLab, an accelerator empowering emerging businesses for catalytic growth.
Okay, wasn't that awesome? That was kind of cool. So one of the things I have to acknowledge is the lab can't function without the support of our agency partners and our agency. So would everybody from Q stand up? And I just want to, all you guys over here who help with the event, everybody that supports our entrepreneur, I just want to absolutely thank all of them for their support and what they do.
An accelerator.
Oh, come on, we heard that. And then you already met Julie Beck. Jeff, could you stand? And Marco, could you stand? And these are some of our advisors that help entrepreneurs. That's the end of the commercial. So let's meet the startups, huh? Okay. So our first startup is Tempo. You guys ready? Okay. Do you guys want to set up a little bit?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So Tempo is a functional beverage, and they're kind of in a pretty exciting space. They have drinks that are infused with CBD. Is anybody here tried CBD? How many recreational drugs? Aha!
Hey, it's different.
Oh, I know it is. I know. So with that, I'm going to hopefully hand this microphone to you guys. Oh, I'll leave it there? Okay. All right. I'll let you guys take it.
You guys hear us okay?
Yeah.
If you can hear me all right, I'm not going to cry. So we're good. Thank you, everyone, for having us here today. Thank you to a very beautiful panel of judges, of course. We are Tempo, a Chicago-based beverage brand looking to take functional wellness beyond the dietary supplement aisle and into the modern lifestyle. Now, to kick things off, we'd like to introduce you to the team behind the product. The team here carries a very differentiated background on the table, from science and finance to CPG and even engineering. My personal story begins in neuroscience, where I got my degree and where I became very interested in the way the brain works and how the environment around us can influence our day-to-day performance. I also spent a decade on Wall Street, writing research reports for hedge funds and doing my time as an M&A investment banker. Basically, that period of my life was insanely stressful. I was living in this world, someone did investment banking. I was living in this world where the work was very fast-paced, expectations were sky high, and I was often functioning on little to no sleep. And as everyone here knows, the brain can be a very tricky thing to manage when you're constantly pushing it to its limit, not giving it the right fuel. And that's when I became inspired to launch Tempo, to help people fuel their minds and bodies better with powerful yet clean natural ingredients. And all of this is possible because of the team standing around me today.
Hi everyone, my name is Kati Karatke. I'm a Chicago native. I have 12 plus years in food and beverage from the agency consulting side, brand management and innovation, and some of the top CPGs. I also am on my third venture-backed startup gig here with these guys. And what I love to do the most is work on consumer product market fit and help take businesses to the next level.
Hey everyone, it's great to be here. Thanks for having Tempo. My name is Grant and been with the business from the beginning. I used to be an engineer, and so my problem-solving approach is very process-oriented. And at Tempo, that means I'm in charge of operations. So when you pop the hood and you look at the guts, I am dealing with the nitty, the gritty. And to us, that means supply chain, and it means scheduling our productions and co-packing and making sure everything is done in time and in budget as well. Ryan and Kati are going to be running through the rest of the presentation while I put together some samples. So take it away, guys.
Doing ops already. All right, so we've got a big problem today, and that's stress. Stress is the enemy of peak performance. Studies show that stress can lower your creativity, impair your performance on simple cognitive tasks, and even affect our ability to forge new social connections. Unfortunately, in the city, it's even worse. City dwellers are 39% more likely to suffer from stress, anxiety, and other mood disorders. Enter CBD, the single most disruptive food trend of our generation. This natural extract from the cannabis plant does not get you high and has been shown to lower stress and help people perform better in situations where anxiety might typically be a distraction. Think of it like meditation in a bottle. Because of its powerful therapeutic potential, CBD is a trend that is booming right now, growing from less than $1 billion category last year to projected $23 billion by 2022. And while the headline is great, what's driving this trend is arguably the most interesting part of the story. This is a category that started in the underground cannabis space, think smoke shops, think dispensaries, and has now emerged on the scene at your corner coffee shop, where you go to grab a sandwich for lunch, your health food store. Now, beverages are a pretty unique part of this trend, because beverages represent a perfect entry point for this modern CBD customer, someone that's looking for something familiar, convenient, a product that they can trust. Beverages grew 101% year over year. CBD infused beverages grew 101% year over year in Q1 of this year, with a trend that's projected to grow 75% year over year for the coming years. And that's all driven by a unique and emerging CBD consumer.
Yeah, so what a category story, right? But let's talk about, is there a real consumer product fit opportunity? So for us, meet Janice. Janice is just graduated from business school last year, management consultant who has very long work weeks, and therefore she places a premium on things that are bringing convenience to her life. That said, she does take some time to hang out in River North in her free time, what little time she has, quite literally, as you can see. And, you know, it's in those moments when she gets to relax and unwind that she is most happy. Therefore, it's products, services, and brands that do that for her that she loves the very most. So we saw that opportunity and that target consumer opportunity, and that's where we went to work.
So, introducing Tempo, a vibrant, modern, mindful brand that elevates consumers to perform better in their day-to-day lives. All of our products are built around a unique and proprietary ingredient set built to serve a specific need, whether that's focus or recovery or energy. We're building a brand for this modern aspirational consumer, the type of person that thinks about their wellness as not just a pill you have every morning, but as a lifestyle.
So let's dig into a little bit, why us? Well, the beverage category is not a sleeping category, right? It's very competitive. And we're only gonna see that competition continue to grow. We think we can compete for a couple of really good reasons. We have a very powerful brand equity. It's vibrant, it catches people, it draws people in, and it brings about a little bit of an emotion that's really helpful to have as you're going forward. Then we also have fantastic taste. We're flavor forward. Our target consumer really does like our product and keeps coming back. Finally, we sit in a couple places in store. Some beverages sit in the fridge, other beverages sit at checkout, and because of our portfolio, we actually can capture people, drive awareness, and have that recall as they walk through the store format. Finally, we have a functional formula that actually delivers, so people can feel good about what's going into their body. And we are Chicago's own, so we are building here, we want to grow here, and then we want to go from there. Now, a competitive advantage is nice, but does it actually have results in the market? So we are seeing early traction. Mind you, the CBD shots were launched just 9 months ago. Very recently, we brought it under the Tempo banner. We're seeing 55% revenue growth over the last 3 months. And since launch, we've had our door count double every quarter. What's more important is that our customers are coming back for more, so we're selling through. What's great, that means we're holding velocities, not just holding velocities, we're actually accelerating those velocities as well. And of course, what I love most, brand love, right? So when people are telling you that they like a product, right, when they say that they would buy it right there on the spot, and then on top of it, they would talk to a friend or a family member about it, that's really great traction for us. So traction comes about, right, when you find a good product market fit, but it also comes down to execution. So we have a very strong go-to-market strategy, but it's also simple. We think of it as simply grab, hook, and hold. We grab people at shelf with our vibrant package, with our displays. We hook them with lots of sampling and lots of LOLs. In our world, that means liquid on lips. But we laugh too. Gets them every time. It's a sweet beat. And we hold and we draw them in, right? So we get out there, we talk about our stories in social, we bring that vibrancy of life and let people really immerse and get caught up in the brand. One specific brand experience that we just had, we will show that to you a little bit later so you can get a better idea of what we're talking about. And of course, this framework is meant to scale. So Basecamp here is Chicago, right? But as we look to go further out, we're looking at other mid-tier one cities where we see that same active on-the-go urban demographic that is so important to us. We also are obviously going to leverage our relationships that we have both personally and through our distributors. It's always helpful to have a little bit of a foothold when you're going into new territories. And of course, cost efficiencies are of mind. We want to stay lean and mean until the point when we have more resources as we then scale nationally.
This targeted regional expansion strategy would allow us to achieve step changes in scale as we continue down that growth path. And it's not just top line revenue, it's also economies of scale in our margin. There's very low hanging fruit right here in the manufacturing, ingredient supply, and materials. But look, I did finance. I know it's fun to look at lofty numbers on a page. None of that matters unless we get the next 6 to 12 months right. And that means Chicago. That means cementing our foothold in the market today, building a cohesive brand archetype, and communicating our message in a way that resonates with the target customer here and can be scaled to other markets as well. Now, I know that's a ton of upfront work, but that's exactly why we're here today.
So let's talk about today, literally. 40 grand or so on the line, and we're here to tell you very explicitly that we are very much in building mode. We do have one major sore spot that we would love to address sooner than later. If you look in the upper left-hand corner, you go to our website and CBD Shots today, that's literally what the site looks like. It does not do justice to the amazing brand that we have and how that brand performs when it's on shelf. We compete really well at shelf with million-dollar, even billion-dollar brands. However, online, we don't have any of that presence or that touch and feel. Furthermore, you see that our competitors from the East Coast, the West Coast, Colorado, have that touch point covered, and that's only going to be increasingly important as we go forward with our e-commerce and direct-to-consumer strategy, and we'd like to get on that sooner rather than later, as you can imagine. So, with that said, we would like to get your support. That's why we're here today. We promise to bring focus to the project at hand. We'll avoid scope creep of all kind, promise. And we thank you for having us here today. So we're going to be handing off some samples for the judges here. And we do have a short video that will show our brand activation. Soldier, baby. Yeah, I know you been like that. Gun it like a holster, baby. Show them say you're wicked like that. We live where the war is raging, chasing our crazy dreams, hoping that the bridge won't cave in. Tonight we'll let it all go free. Give me the thing, I'll make me rock and have a dance. Give me the thing, I'll make me rock and have a dance. Now she don't like skipping out of the dance. Give me the thing, I'll make me rock. Give me the thing, I'll make me rock.
We've got 5 minutes.
Ask a question. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
First of all, great job.
Thank you so much.
A couple things. So my space is kind of retail, go to market, and just wondering if you're in retail today. You talked a little bit about you're starting in Chicago. Can you talk a little bit more about that? And also, are you getting any resistance with CBD being kind of the unknown, not approved by FDA? Is that coming up as an issue at all?
Yeah, I'll start and I'll go backwards on that. So regulatory side is very important to stay close to. There's a lot of confusion in the market today. I actually have sympathy for the FDA in this situation because they were put in a very uncomfortable position when the Farm Bill was passed in December of 2018. People immediately turned to them and said, okay, what do we do and how do we do it? Now, FDA usually takes them a couple years to set new guidance on a product, but you know, to their credit, they've been moving fast, but they've also left these breadcrumbs. So what they've always said in their guidance, they say we are exercising regulatory discretion and we'll target companies that lie about the content of the product or make egregious health claims. And that's been true. Every time any company has received a warning letter, it's been for one of those two reasons. So basically what they've been telling us is operate like a food company properly, do your right testing, and we do a lot of testing on our product, and carry the industry forward that way. So, you know, we feel like we have a responsibility to the industry as stewards of the category to give the right impression, set it down the right path. So we spend a lot of time trying to operate properly, not create any issues with the FDA, and do it that way. So that has worked well to our advantage. And I'll let Kati talk a little bit about the in-market.
Yeah, so we are currently in market. This is a very high-level overview breakdown of where our distribution is. So not surprisingly, we do incredibly well in specialty grocers. So think like Goddess and Grocer, for example, in all their locations. That's our core target demo. C-Store as well, because of the pack size, does very well at checkout. And then from there, it kind of spreads out a little bit for us. But yes, it's going very well. We're roughly in about, we have about 44 points of distribution right now.
We've had the benefit of 3+ years of doing the non-CBD line, which is available in Whole Foods statewide today.
Yep.
And the good part there is we've seeded the market with a non-CBD product, and as CBD becomes more recognized, it's a great entree for the shots, and we've seen it be like a dovetailing effect.
And you find out both the temple and the shots available, the cans and the shots?
Yep.
Yeah, they're both in the market today.
Yep. And we'll continue to evolve it and focus ourselves towards the CBD space.
You guys mentioned, you guys mentioned the website.
Yeah.
So who's running it right now? Is it one of you? Is it your brother? Is it a customer?
Yeah, sometimes.
Also our head of IT, but thanks.
Yeah, conveniently they said all the bad things about it while I was on stage, so thanks.
Grant.ecommerce at TempoBuild.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we have to wear a lot of hats, and that includes web development at times. So, yeah, that's something that we had to build in-house.
Can you talk a bit about your market research that you've done, right? So you have a slide with some kind of high-level, whatever percent of consumers like our product. What does that mean? Where did that come from?
Yep.
How many are these actual consumers? Is this a focus group? How did you do this work?
Yeah, so a couple things. One, we do sampling quite consistently of our products that are already in market just to make sure that we're tracking and getting some of this data that I speak to. We're in a WeWork, which is actually fantastic. So for anyone who's ever worked in a WeWork, you know that the WeWork is actually incredibly supportive of pushing out communications, of scheduling, of sampling, and so people will walk by during lunch periods or in their free time or just as an excuse to get away from the desk and the other teammates to try products that are out there. And so in that time, that's when we will field questions and we'll do some basic NPS type testing or those types of things to get these metrics. As it relates to product development and innovation development, there we'll actually then have more structured sign up. Whereby we sort of curate the people that we bring in, make sure they're open to using CBD products, don't bring any biases, but then put them through sort of tasting and focus group work as we build that innovation pipeline. So it's a balance of informal, right, which is important because that's more representative of the real world, and then something a little bit more formalized just because we're obviously investing quite heavily as we put new products in the market.
And I'll add, I love that question because this data is so important at how we build our brand and how we validate what we're doing. We had two MBA interns over the summer, and they spent 100% of their time in the field doing exactly that.
Yeah.
That's how important it is to our brand.
Yeah. And it goes for end consumer, but as Ryan was saying, our customers as well, right? So talking to them, really understanding what they like about the product, where it can sit in the store, where it can be of greatest value to them, so that we know that we're buzz going into this going forward.
While you have the customer slide up, can you share a little bit about your estimated customer lifetime value and
Yeah, so I think, you know, we think of it a little bit more from a perspective of it's CPG, so this is not a SaaS model per se, right? And so we know we have to go out there and win a consumer every single day, right? And so as we think about that, we think more from a point of acquiring customers and points of distribution in those doors and scaling up. And so some of the numbers that Ryan backed into,
we've kind of modeled out, okay, if we can, you know, get those doors to continue to double quarter over quarter, that'll get us to the point where we need to go, knowing that people will usually fall off, right? So expecting 80% fall off after a first trial. If they do like the product, if they don't like the product, we know they're fundamentally just not going to come back. So.
And to add one more layer to that, we've seen this connection between retail and e-commerce. So you saw, okay, e-commerce, there's work to be done. A lot of our purchases in the e-commerce side of it are people that found it on the shelf in the store and decided to come back and buy more and buy more.
Yeah.
So we've seen this connection between that. So that adds one layer to the lifetime value of the customer.
Can you talk a little bit more about your previous non-CBD product? Where did you launch that? What are the ingredients, or what's the kind of?
Yep, so what you see here is what Grant alluded to. Version 1.0. We launched that towards the end of 2017. We did a pilot, really brought it out to market more second half of 2018.
In a different packaging, we started out in a glass format.
The idea behind that product was, you know, like I said, we're trying to target these pain points during the day. We're not an ingredient company, we're a functional wellness company that's baked into the modern lifestyle. So we found that there was a problem. You have, in the energy drink space, there's high octane, everyone knows it, Red Bull, and then you have caffeine free. But what's in the middle? It's sodas. And you have this huge trend towards natural health and wellness on both ends of the spectrum, the barbell, but in the middle, there really wasn't much innovation. So we said, well, let's create a better energy profile through tea, and let's over-concentrate the teas a little. So we made a product that was like a double tea, and it had the same caffeine profile as diet soda, but without all the junk. So that's what we brought to market today. It did really well in offices. We continue to carry that forward. We might be putting it on tap in some offices now. That was version 1.0.
The other thing we noted about that is a lot of the competition, the Red Bulls, the Monsters, were very masculine brands. And we very intentionally created something that was not a heavily masculine brand, something that's a little bit more neutral and maybe, if anything, slightly feminine. And that's been a good key differentiator for us on shelf.
Last super quick question.
Yes.
How many stores or locations are you currently in?
Yeah, so we're in right now 22 doors or so, with just over 44 or so points of distribution, roughly, with the two SKUs on the shots. And then you can add in the Whole Foods, which is just our sparkling cans. So.
Okay, with that.
Okay, so we've got. Next, a SaaS company. As we all know, SaaS is a hot market, right? So Route is a business management SaaS-based platform for service companies. They have an innovative mobile and web app that helps improve business management and increases profitability. I'm going to bring up those guys to talk about that now. So welcome, Route.
How you guys doing? My name is Ricky Rigolato. This is Armando Bello. I am the CEO and founder of Route. Armando's our business development manager. We got some other men in black out here. They're part of the team as well. He nailed it with Route is a business-to-business SaaS cloud-based solution for the commercial cleaning and maintenance industry, otherwise known as like the building services industry. So before I go into it real quick, I did want to play a quick video. I don't have anything tangible or anything for you guys to touch, feel, or smell. So I did want to give you guys just a quick 10-second outlook of what the app looks like and the functionality. If we could play that real quick. All right, do I do it? No, I don't do that. Maybe? While they're doing that, so to dig a little deeper, we're going to go into the solution itself, but it's a high overview. It's a business management software solution. So what we're doing is there's a lot of operational items that are out there for the field service industry, right? There's a big trend on the B2B SaaS environment, but in our space, a lot of people forgot about the front end, sales solution. How good is a field service company without sales? You can't get off the ground, you can't scale. And why I say why me? Why did I come up with this? My wife and I started a commercial cleaning company 6 years ago. We actually just made the Inc. 5000. We're number 1496 this year. And that was just in about 6 years. But how did we do that? How did a cleaning company create a software? Rick, who the hell are you to create software? You're not in technology. You don't know software. It's because I hired the right guys. And I was very open to what could be done. And I am a subject matter expert in this scenario. So we live it, breathe it, love it. It's not a glamorous industry, but it is as close to recession-proof as you can get. Everybody here needs cleaning. Everybody needs things fixed. So if we can empower those service providers with tools that are gonna help them win more business, bid better, stop underbidding, propose pricing better, I feel we have a good solution here, right? So I don't think we're gonna get to play the video.
That sucks, sorry.
But a little bit more too on the actual market size, right? Because you guys may not know a lot about the actual market. It's not glamorous, so a lot of people kind of shove it to the side. But it's pretty big. There's over 1.1 million commercial cleaning companies in the U.S. alone. It's projected to be about 12 million in the world. Cleaning technicians, which are the people that are going to be touching the product, using the product, benefiting from this product, just in the U.S. there's over 3.5 million technicians, and this industry is growing year after year. The market size itself, but it includes supplies, chemicals, manufacturing as well, is about $178 billion market. We're trying to go after the $60.5 billion market. Again, just in the U.S. alone. So it gives you the idea of what the scalability possibilities are for this archaic industry. CRE tech is getting big right now. Prop tech is getting big. We're at the forefront of what we feel is a forgotten solution is on the front end sales side.
Cool. So that there is the opportunities, right? So within that, there are a few key things within the commercial cleaning space, right, which are noted here. So typically, as of today, there are a lot of old-fashioned methods in performing your day-to-day activities within the cleaning space, right? We're still going out with a pen and paper in order for us to perform a walkthrough, right? A walkthrough is essentially where we go out to the prospect's facility in order for us to gauge what it is that we're actually gonna perform, right? In order for us to provide them with the bid. We need to gather enough information in order for us to service them well and in order for us to provide the right proposal, right? What's happening is we're actually rushing this process, right? So we're not gathering the right data. We're not gathering the right fixture counts, the floor types, dimensions, et cetera, right? So once we get back to the office, what's happening is now I'm trying to gather my thoughts, right? I'm trying to upload pictures into my computer, right? Now I'm trying to just remember the chicken scratches that are on my notes, right? What did they actually address while on site, right? It's a lot of tedious work, and it's like this traditionally. So what that's doing is it's not allowing me as a service company to service the client well throughout the duration of the contract, right? Additionally, what I'm doing is now I'm underbidding my contracts. So now I have these uncomfortable conversations with these clients where I have to ask for more money on a month-to-month basis, right? Additionally, when it comes to the scheduling, it's tedious work, right? What we're actually doing is what we had to do is actually go through these applications in order for us to see where somebody's located, whether or not they have driving abilities, right, or what their schedule looks like. But what we're trying to do is we're trying to solve for that, right? In addition to that, there is currently no performance tracking on site. So there's platforms where you can clock in, you can clock out, but nobody really knows what's taking place while on site. It's kind of like this black hole, right? So what we're trying to do is we're trying to solve for that in order for these cleaning companies, our cleaning company, to provide more efficient quotes in order for us to grow as an organization. Now, based on the scheduling, right, skills, the time that it's taking to travel on site, right, unfortunately, what we're doing is we're actually suffering a 200% turnover rate as an organization because some of these key factors, right? In addition to that, 93% of the industry is stuck under that $1 million mark, right? We're capping ourselves because we don't have the right tools in order for us to actually scale our organization. Now, our target market. Our target market is this, is we're focusing in on organizations that have anywhere from 11 to 200 employees and an annual revenue of $1 to $10 million, right? We're focusing in on this, on these types of companies because we have noticed that just based on our research, these companies are more, I guess you could say they're not so big stuck on the old traditional ways, but they've actually implemented some type of technology within their infrastructure, right? So this is who we want to go after. However, if you notice here, that only makes up 64,000 organizations within our space. There are about 540,000 micro enterprises that is essentially our bread and butter, right? These are organizations that are looking to grow, but are still using your typical Microsoft, right, suite to run their organizations where they haven't really found a technology that is affordable in order for them to actually scale with companies. This is who we want to go after. So there's definitely a growth potential there.
Yeah. All right, so overview of the product itself, because again, cleaning space, you guys might not be familiar with it. As far as the features that we've done, we're starting with the walkthrough. We actually trademarked the walkthrough builder within the building services space. Big feat for us because it's a very universal term, but in our space, a lot of different type of target market clients are using it. You got moving relocation companies, property managers, handyman, maintenance services, but today we'll touch on our core competency is commercial cleaning, right? So when I do a walkthrough, right? A walkthrough is you're going through this space. You would have seen the video. You would take your pictures of a space. This kind of a piano bar, or not piano bar, but piano event space, has traditionally bathrooms in the back. You got event space in an area. You got a kitchenette. You probably have a couple little small offices. We have done preset templates of those type of location categories in the app itself. So before you arrive on site, you already have an area by area, kind of a guide to what you're walking through, right? Then when that walkthrough is performed, you're capturing, like Armando was saying, is square feet. The pictures are being able to be marked up, just like you see on Instagram, right? Where you can kind of make notes for yourself on, hey, that's a hot point right there. Gabe likes his plant to be dusted every single Friday. That's not a common task. You still got to capture those details, but we've already preset the common task too. So Greg, who's in the audience, right? He started 9 months ago on our customer success team. He's never been involved in cleaning. This guy can do walkthroughs better than my sales teams because the tool is guiding you to perform a legitimate, worthy walkthrough. So from walkthrough, the journey map now is it starts to trigger every event. A walkthrough then turns into the bidding and estimating tool within the platform. So within the platform, we're able to give you productivity rates, able to give you what your hourly rate is gonna be to clean. Because what these people, as far as the cleaning companies and the small to medium-sized businesses, is they're struggling with how do I bid? You know, we're watching it on social media all the time. It's how do I bid a 5,000 square foot restaurant cleaning it 7 days a week? They're hungry to know that knowledge. That knowledge isn't out there. You know, everybody bids their own way. We're trying to bring that and aggregate that all together within our tool. So now from the bidding and estimating tool, what's next? It's the contract and the proposal. Well, guess what? You don't have to leave our platform. You're doing the proposal within the platform again. So now we've taken you from walkthrough, bidding and estimating, and then we've taken you to the proposal generation, which they, you know, and again, all this came from is my pain points first, 2 years ago. I was using probably 7 software solutions to operate my business. I was not able to scale. I was not able to delegate to where today I stepped away as a CEO about 4 months ago from Rosalotto, running the show here with Route with these guys now, but it's because I have people in place using our software to be able to scale and grow into 9 states right now, all up to 300 employees. But when you go from proposal generation, guess what? You win the contract, we're not done yet. It becomes client contract management now. So now you have a client card system, right? We've taken a little bit from Trello to try to make this a modernized approach because you know that the second generation companies, owners are coming in. And what does the second generation want? They want technology. They want modernized tools. They want something that's UI sexy, UX lovely, right? So what we've done is being able to do that on a digitized platform where it takes you from step to step. So client card management, what's important with that is the fact that you have accounting that's able to talk to sales, that's able to talk to scheduling. Never been done before. I have an office where people get up out of their seat, they walk over to the other corner. What are we billing this client? Cool. Walk over to this side, to the trainer, say, hey, when did we start this account? I'm like, what? How is it? Why are we operating this way? Our software alleviates that. I was able to do a walkthrough in Philadelphia and my team in Chicago submitted a proposal before I even got done with the walkthrough in Philadelphia. So it's that kind of an approach that we're bringing.
Perfect. And I know we have, did we buy 3 minutes? Did the check clear? Okay. All right. So we kind of went into the secret sauce. We've gone into that. Now, our competition, right? Our competition is essentially great at what they essentially specialize in, right? So as you can see here, there's platforms that are great for client locations, for bidding, for estimating, but nobody really has that full front solution, right? That front end sales process into the back end operations, right? We want departments to be able to speak to one another, and that's where Route comes in, right? One solution for your organization. So I know I'm kind of rushing through this now, but our go-to-market strategy is this. You know who we're going after, you know what it is that we're servicing, but how, right? So we have essentially three tiers. So within the SaaS platform, you have your starter package, which is essentially geared towards organizations that are gonna have no more than 3 users on the platform, right? They have technician profiles, they have unlimited walkthrough, unlimited inspections. However, they're limited to 5 proposals. Now, that number there is reset as you download and then save it per the client card that Ricky talked about a second ago, or you go ahead and delete it. That number will be then reset, and then you go ahead and create a new one. Now, our growth package is everything that a starter package includes. In addition to that, it'll be unlimited users. You'll have the unlimited job, task workflow, and then custom reporting. And then our pro plan that'll actually be launching within the next month will be everything previously stated, in addition to contract management, scheduling, building, and then reoccurring jobs, and then our chatbot, which Ezra is working on, our data scientist there. What we've been able to do up to this date is go out to trade shows, publications that Ricky's been a part of, being that he is a subject matter expert right within the space. We've been able to do educational content within YouTube, our YouTube channel, Facebook groups and things of that nature. And then we have, can I buy 2 more minutes?
Go back.
2 more minutes. Community engagement, we've actually just started hosting events at our office where we're inviting commercial cleaning companies within the Chicagoland area in order for us to have our suppliers, our equipment sponsors come out and provide that type of feedback as well as our technology platform. Social media, influencer partnerships, and then our 3-year forecast. As of today, we've actually just surpassed 100,000 in revenue. We're on pace to hit 200K. And then we have 102 users and then 30 beta testers for our pro plan. And then our plan for the 40K is for all of our social media, SEO, content creation, trade shows, and things of that nature. Sorry, we went over
time. You did a good job.
So we did work with ISSA and Janssen, and I could tell you the market is ripe for this type of innovation. So very, very good and very killer that you guys are focused on that. So I'm very aware of it. I also would give it up to these guys for their ability to visualize. And there was a little bit of passion there, if I thought of it. So that's what everybody wants to see. That's what everybody wants to see. So judges, some questions?
Great job, guys.
Thank you.
I'm sorry about the video, but I think you did a really nice job of helping us understand. No, you really did a nice job of explaining it. My one question was, I noticed you're going after kind of that mid-market, and just curious, since I don't know the space that well, why not the bigger guys? Like, why not the big fish? What do they use today?
So we talked to some of the big fish, right? There's a company called Able Services. They're a $900 million janitorial services provider. You know, wined and dined, had a good conversation with them, but we found that the barrier to entry with them is going to be a much longer entry because they have 19 payroll managers, right? They have a system that has worked to get them to where they're at. And first and foremost is the technicians in the field. They're having a hard time just clocking in and out with mobile applications right now. I know it. I see it. So they don't want to risk that disruption between good team and good personnel, that if they implement a new app to say, hey, you want workforce management, sounds great, we want it, but it's to attack a 1,000 employee plus company, it's gonna be hard. So we're just conversations, but that's why middle market's better.
To add on that, they've also generated enough revenue in order for them to build something in-house that works perfectly for their organization, right? So when it comes to us customizing something for them,
legitimately we don't have the manpower to do so, right? So they've built something that's working well for them. So that literally makes up 1% of the industry. So why go after the 1% when they're still 99%?
So I got a quick question I'm going to bring in as well. So I know that we also worked in property management software, which is not the same but similar because you have to do walkthroughs of hotels, things like Definitely. That. So one of the things we've seen is gobbling up of the market, right? So is your strategy get as much market share as you can and then you're on an acquisition?
Oh, yeah.
Or, okay, so talk a little bit about that and who would be your acquisition, who would acquire you, where are you aiming so that they can hear?
Yeah, so there's a company, so in our space, there's probably 4 to 5 main recognized companies in our space because we go to the ISSA show. There's a company called Team Software. They are the 800-pound gorilla. But it's a very ERP robust system that was accounting first. Then they created things.
And they're more expensive.
More expensive.
Much more.
And they're geared for the 1%. They are the 1% solution. Where I couldn't even use them 3 years ago. I'd have to have 3 people hired just to manage their software. And they already actually reached out last month. So they tried to come, the CEO flew over. He sees what we're building.
Yeah.
So we have open API. So our plan is to integrate with a couple solutions already. They're a play for us, yeah. Because I mean, they own the 1% of the market, so we'd be dumb not to.
Can you guys talk a bit about how you ensure that the people in the field adopt and use this product, right? I bet that's a big challenge. People are kind of everywhere. They have different technology, probably have to provide their own phones, right? These parent companies aren't giving them phones. So how do you make sure that they use it, properly, it's not breaking down, they're not going back to their clipboard and relying upon that?
Good old clipboard.
Yeah.
So it's our approach coming in the front end or the front sales solution has been easier than if we would have gone after my original idea, which was workforce management first with like beacons, that we would hit a brick wall. Mm-hmm. But coming in front end, sales, business operators, management, they're way more open to using the tool because they're starting to see, wow, this is saving me time. I can be in 3 places at the same time. And it's allowing them to do their job better. So by going after them first, they're then saying, hey, well, the inspection team, because we have an inspection app, because again, the walkthrough is like an inspection. So with the inspections, they're going into it saying, oh, well, the sales team, they're speaking highly of this product. Let's go ahead and just use the inspection side. Well, guess what comes next is workforce management. So we're hoping that the adoption will be very strong because the other departments have already adopted.
Let me ask you more question about the exit thing. So I pulled up a slide of like, you know, your trajectory. Mm-hmm. What size do you guys think you have to achieve to kind of be a potential exit? You know, so how much market share, what kind of, you have good velocity of growth, you know, projected, but what are you kind of trying to target?
I mean, if we can get just a number out there is if we could even capture 5 to 10,000 companies in our space, not one software owns that amount of users in companies. Because a lot of single solution is out there where there's inspection apps, there's time attendance apps, there's supply ordering apps. But because we're bringing it all together, we could capture 5,000 companies, 10,000 companies. We are a very attractable, or is that even a word? A very attractive company at that point because now the market size is in our favor. You know, nobody, if you have 1,000 companies in our space, you're considered a big software solution. That's crazy when there's 1 million cleaning companies out there.
Yep, and so that makes sense a little bit. So as I showed during the competition slide, there's companies that are great within their respective fields, right? So there might be a software company that has 1,000 users, another with 800, another one with 1,500, 2,000, or whatever the case may be, but nobody has that one-stop shop like we do. So if we can get 5 to 10,000, we can get those other companies that are already adopting technology to jump on board, then we have the market share.
Okay, we have time for one more question if anybody has one.
So I know going back to your product slide, you have, I think it was the basic and the step up product. Amongst those 100 customers today, you know, how many are using your basic product or the I think it's the growing team product, and kind of what's the average number of user seats?
So I think we're at about 65, 70%.
It's about 70-30 right now. So it's about 70% within that starter, and then 30% within the actual pro plan.
And are you finding that existing customers are upselling, so adding seats as they continue to work with you?
Exactly.
It starts once they, because this walkthrough building exercise has never been done before. So once they see how that's a value add, they upgrade or they pay for the entire year because they already know, okay, well, I want to get in now before the price is raised after this year. Because this is a founders member type of pricing for this first year. Once 2020 comes, we have Pro Tier that's coming, and then we have the work order ticket portal system that's coming for our straight for property management.
So, and let's tag on that really quick. Yes, because initially, what's happening is we're getting their sales reps, right? It's an owner-operator type of organization, and we're getting their sales reps that they're essentially training up, which is essentially leading up to just 3 users. But as they start to get operations, they start to see the full functionality within the platform. They know that each department can speak to one another, which then leads them to upgrade into the pro, and then the pro afterwards.
Absolutely.
Okay, gentlemen, let's get into it. All right, so we have one more, and then we'll have a short break after. So this group, everybody knows that Brazilian trends are kind of really continuing to grow in the United States, right? And within that, I think this next group really represents an interesting space. They're first in the Chicago market to really have an entirely dedicated Brazilian design boutique. They are a early stage company. They have a lot of heart. They have really good vision. They have a lot of products they're unpacking right now. And I think I would just add, got a chance to look at these guys, and one of the cool things that they're doing is they're supporting local Brazilian artists and jewelry makers. And one of the things I think that's just great about what they're doing is, they're kind of working almost in a fair trade, if you guys are familiar with the vernacular kind of method. So I'm very happy to introduce, I'm going to probably slaughter this name really bad, Belina Caetano.
Yes, you
got it. Belino Caetano, legal.
A little complicated.
complicated, and I am Bella Caetano by accident because my original name is Bella July, because my mom didn't know English, so she put that name there. Batista Fritz. But then once I got to Chicago, people started calling me Bella Caetano, and I became Bella Caetano, the designer of Belina Caetano. That sounds so fancy that I started being fancy. And what is Belina Caetano? Who are we? Well, we are the very first space in Chicago, all dedicated to the Brazilian design. How many of you have heard about Brazilian design or even know what Brazilian design looks like? She knows because you are in fashion and we are really good with fashion. Yeah, so there is none. There is none around Chicago. There is none really around the United States. There is maybe a few here and there, maybe New York, there is one or two, Miami, because all the Latinas are right there, but there is not really. So I, as a founder, decided to go into this journey and just become the Made in Brazil lady. And then we start Made in Brazil by the Brazilians, because in the world that we are living in, we have to remember that behind a product, there is people. There are people, you know? We can't forget that people are still here. The machines, the computers, the technology will get better. But I believe that us as humans, we are also gonna get better. And here's my Brazilian jewelry. So like I said, I don't have a formal education, but I did attend 4 years of architecture in Brazil. And that's what allowed me to figure out how to design a product. And my passion was just driven day after day. And when I decided that I was gonna marry that gentleman and become a US resident, I had to figure out my life. I dropped architecture school. I was like, I don't know, this is gonna cost me way too much to follow up in America. And I decided to design jewelry, and my pride was make it in Brazil. Can we make jewelry in Brazil in a large scale and compete with the giants? Oh no, yes we can. That video that you saw, it's my facility over there, and it's giant and it has all the infrastructure. And this is Feitos do Brasil, works of Brazil. Because when I was selling just door to door, basically when I got here in 2017, the wow factor was Brazilian. Like, jewelry, oh my gosh, it's crowded. Every market that I signed up for was like 20 jewelers. One another thing, but jewelry's everywhere, everywhere. But the Brazilian wow factor, no, I want Brazilian jewelry, I don't have any Brazilian. And that actually clicked me something else. I was like, there's a category right there, made in Brazil. And that's when I started this movement, and I started, just many ideas came to my mind, and I'm like, oh my gosh, look how many things we can make in Brazil. And I was all over the place, and I'm like, Bella, just center, you need a plan. So I divided them into categories. And the first one that I decided was handbags, because it was just easier for me to follow up after the jewelry to accessories. And I just scrolled my Instagram, found this amazing artist, interviewed them, and I made sure to get people from Espírito Santo, like Gabriela, she does like macrame, and then Leonardo from Ceará, which is Northeast, and then Lessa Soares from Rio, and then Sandro from São Paulo. So I try to do a mix, because Brazil is not just Rio, Brazil is not just São Paulo, we have a huge country, and they all have their own little culture that is so beautiful and no one talks about. Well, we want to talk about. And that would not be possible without the Brazilian experience. Are you guys ready to samba? Just kidding. Actually, this is our most recent accomplishment on 900 North Michigan Avenue. We are there. I don't know how, don't ask me. And this is a beautiful space in Chicago that you guys can visit. It's on the level 5 together with Astor Hall. And you can find there all these beautiful designs, my jewelry, and the whole experience. So this is a real picture of my shop. It's not like a oasis, it is an oasis in Chicago. It's a tropical mirage that exists on the wine hunter shops. So you can go there, grab a Brazilian coffee with me, sit on my sofa, and I will talk more because we need time here so I can keep talking. And this is the need. Oh my gosh. There is a need for a Brazilian space in Chicago. Who here would visit a Brazilian space? I would. And so why there is not a place in Chicago or everywhere else? Well, there is a big disconnect between the international market and the artists from Brazil. There's no one really doing that bridge as well as I have here in my mind. And why is that a such important need? Well, because the markets in Brazil were not explored yet. We only hear about made in China, made in India. Now there's a trend made in Morocco. But what about the Brazilians? We need work too, we need jobs. So I'm here to create that community, that bridge for us to accomplish that. And why is it gonna work? Because we are fostering social and profitable business models. Because today the millennials, we have the power, we have the money, we are all young, and we work, and we want to spend the money, and we want to spend it well. And we don't do anything these days if it's not to fulfill us. Getting a nice bag at Gucci, it might be nice, I want one, but knowing that you are buying a bag, carrying around, and that this bag is part of someone's dreams, that is what makes me sleep at night, you know? And the international Brazilian community, they also want a place to go. They want a community. They want a place to go to show to their little kids. This is Brazil. I'm gonna have my kids soon, and I want a place to take them to show this is Brazil. This is their culture, this is their food, this is their art of work. And I have all kinds of ideas. I can go further, but we want like a library that has Portuguese books, you know, to create this experience. We want a paradise in Chicago. When it's cold, very cold, just go to Belina Caetano. Yes, we are probably gonna get you a very warm scenario there. And we do have a strategy. So first, we are gonna create Brazilian alliances. And we have already done that. I have contacted government, people who are really ready for someone to have the idea that I had, you know? Because they have funds over there. They want the product to go out of the country. They want the product to reach this international market. So they are willing to help, but I need a little help from here too, you know, to connect the two dots. And then once we have that done, we need an efficient platform so that we can build this big bridge. So we are working on that. Being on 900 Shop Michigan is a start, and we can even improve that. And then the main thing is our customer experience, because these days, with internet being such a big deal, your retail space needs to be a place worth going. Otherwise, they're not gonna go. Things change, game over. These big companies, they need to adjust. And small companies like us who are just starting, we need to start with the right foot. And I think we are doing that very well. Otherwise, we would not have a couch in our store. Because that takes that much space, and then the profit, and then like the square feet that's gonna generate, la, la, la. I'm like, forget about it. I want my coffee with my customers, and I want to tell my story, okay? Leave me alone. And then content creation. Once you get that customer, you need to follow up with them. You already got them excited about Brazilian. But then, what's next? They're gonna forget because there's nothing about Brazil out there. So we are working very hard to create all this content. This person's from Ceará. Where's Ceará? What do they have? Which people live there? Are they in the Amazon where there's just animals? No, the Amazon, actually, we have a very good IT campus. You know, like we have very high technology. There's not just like snakes and and how are we gonna just have that long-term relationship with our customers? How are we gonna retain them so our customer acquisition doesn't go high? Once we spend a little money to get them here, we don't want to spend any more money with you guys because coffee is very cheap and I can't keep giving coffee to you guys. But then we need you to stay. And how you stay is because we are able to source products in Brazil. And when I say we, it's basically me and my team because we speak Portuguese, ta-da! And then we can technically book a flight and go over there and just buy our products, source everything. And then our business model, so what happens is that our operational costs didn't meet already our potential because we're brand new. We're like 30 days into the 900 shops. Our pricing, amazing, because I found a way to cut everyone, fair trade. I go direct to the people who need the money. There's no middlemen. Our margins are average 80% on the jewelry, 80%. And when I say that, it's because the best seller, like this guy right here, it's 94 margin. And you guys are gonna hate me, are not gonna like to buy my jewelry anymore, but that's needed because our operational is big because we are creating value, we are creating content. So we put that money towards the experience. And the sales and distribution, well, in store, excellent. They come in, they shop because they love the store. Online, it's so crowded, we need help. And then lifetime value, well, our long term is to become reference on Brazilian products. Where do I buy Brazilian products? Right there, on Belina Caetano. And then future growth, well, right now, we have Brazilian jewelry, very figured out. We already do that. We have the Brazilian accessories that we are working on. And then we have the Brazilian goods, which is unlimited. So there's no cap on how much we can sell or how much products we can import. This is our evolution. So 2017, I only had like tables around town to set up and make some sales. 2018, we went to the 900 shop as a pop-up. I had 3,500 in my pocket from like the whole year of work. And I'm like, can I stay here for 1 month? I promise I'll pay. Mm. And they're like, yes, actually you can. And then I rent a space in the 900 shops for 1 month. And actually that month we made money to pay for 2 more months. And that's how we stayed. And now in 2019, we signed a 2-year contract. And now I think we are gonna just stay there. Mm-hmm. And our progress, I won't go very deep here, but we have been growing year by year, more than doubling. So I'm not afraid of that. And I would not have done this without these people. I didn't have with them just 10 minutes. I actually had with them like a lot of hours to convince them I'm broke, I don't have money, would you work for me? And they're all saying yes. And I'm like, okay, so we can do this. Ana Luisa is my marketing, so she works on creating all this crazy content. Tyler gets us really good pictures that you can see in our website that doesn't sell yet, but it's going to. And then Tommy, my husband, he takes care of our numbers and he says, babe, the numbers are growing, keep doing. But I don't see anything. Just keep doing, it's doubling. And then Fernanda, my Brazilian friend, who is a beautiful, genuine Brazilian. So if I am not in the shop, people who walk in, they want to talk to a Brazilian. They want to see a Brazilian, you know? So Fernanda is my extension. She wears many hats, she does everything. If I'm not there in the shop, she's there to have coffee with you. And well, we need Q Lab because we have everything in place. We have the channel. We can source all the products. We can deliver great experience, even make you samba if needed. And but we need to get this message out there. We need to be on TV. It's my dream, please. And I have a time. No, I made it. I went from Brazil to America, and I'm here.
Wow. Anybody want to go first on the judging panel?
I'm so excited to talk more.
Oh. you mentioned profit margins. It says, what's your least expensive product and then your most expensive product on the higher and the low end?
Okay. So I have probably like 2, 3, 4 products that are $38 because I would not feel comfortable if I couldn't sell to everyone. So I want everyone to walk in my shop that loves my story. I need a product for them. And I'm at 900 shops. So, you know, like people went there and they didn't buy because it's not expensive enough for them. I'm like, okay, fine. And then this necklace that I'm wearing here, this is my most expensive piece. This is 288. dollars. Not bad at all. But of course, the big, big margins are in the middle. The products that are around $58, $78, you guys have many of them right there in front. The quality is so amazing, so good. And yeah, the price point, everyone in this room, I believe, can be a Velina lady, or you guys can make a Velina lady happy at home.
So right now you mentioned you have around 94% gross margins on your jewelry line. What are your margins on some of the accessories and products that you're basically creating the marketplace for?
So that's where it comes why I need help. Because jewelry, when I started, is because simply it was so little, because I thought about logistics. I'm gonna go live to the other way, like across the ocean. I was in architecture. My first feeling was decor. People go to the shop, they want to take the store home. And I'm like, no, this is Amazon, I don't sell this. No, this is like, I don't know, like Marshalls, I don't sell this, just go there. So I couldn't start with decor. And I was like, jewelry, the logistics of jewelry is fantastic. A little box, right, this, it's my entire collection, and it comes so easy from Brazil, you know? But then when it comes to these other products and all the other goods that are coming next, it's bigger. So we need higher quantities for the shipping to be worthy. Right now, these bags right now, they cost around 50% the cost, and then 50% is just to get from there to here, because I need help to make it as big so then I can ship a container from Brazil and not just use the post office, basically. So that's how we lower all the margins. It's basically a logistic thing.
So do you have any other plans as you scale to be able to have enough margin to afford the bigger products, whether that's doing assembly in the US?
And that's exactly where I know exactly, just because a big chunk of it is transportation. So I know these products have great price to compete. We just need to make sure that they get here with a competitive price, because they're not terrible margins. They are still 60% margin. And I just stipulate that for the Feitos do Brasil, and it's 60%. Some we became a little bit too high, but we kept that way, and people are just buying to support, so they are really buying it, and they don't complain about the price, because this is a real, genuine leather that I worked with Sandro, and this goes for $238. So it's not crazy, you know? I could make it 80% margins. I could. Do I have the name to do that yet? Not yet. But we are going to get there.
So you talked a lot about your physical space and the experience that's happening there. And then you talked about online sales as well. Where do you see the biggest growth happening? So, because those are two super different things, have potential for sure, but the in-person experience is very specific. You talked about a library and you know, bookstore and coffee, right, the couch, exactly. Or is it like an Etsy store, an online store? Where do you see that growth?
So I really see the growth on the online, just because now we have like close to nothing. And we can deliver that experience as well in terms of music, because people are very like, they can hear, of course, and then when they are there, they might hear Brazilian music that they can interact to. We love putting out like videos and content so that they can get in that Brazilian thing, you know? And that will lead them to go to the shop, you know? And also for future growth, how online is gonna work? We wanna have all types of Brazilian goods, correct? And my main focus after the accessories is repeat goods. Soap, for example. You buy a soap, you love it. Someone went from here to Chicago, got a box of soap to you, Brazilian from the Amazon, la la la, went to California, gave it to you. You can't go to Chicago to get more, but you can go to the website to get more. So for online strategy, the strategy is repeat goods. Goods that someone get, like a bag of Brazilian coffee, someone gets you as a gift, you love it, you go to the website. So I don't think people who are putting a lot of money online for design it can work, it might work. I don't know how, you know, because online is really like the guys with drinks. It's really for you to go after you touch base with a company, you know? Because our website right now has like 2,000 like views in our pictures and all that, but guess what? They are waiting to go to the shop, you know? So design is really hard to sell design online. That's just from my perspective.
So I think great questions from the panel, great presentation, really enjoyed it. We could take a short intermission now. There's some food back there. Please eat something. We have a ton of food. Get some drinks, or get some, we're not doing drinks yet, but get some beverages, and then we'll conclude with the last two. Thank you, guys.
on. I just reset here. Hold on. I was outside taking pictures. Okay, we're back in. Great. Hold on. One more. Nice. Cool. Got it. Thank you.
Hey, can you pictures like at the podium? It's not.
Okay.
Really good. That was impressive.
I know too.
It's turning into a mob. It's become unruly. Okay, is everybody coming in? How are we doing? Are we chasing everybody down? Okay. All right, so we've got our last two. Can we dim the lights a little bit, or is it just the way it was? It seems like they're brighter. Yeah? Thank you. All right, so we've got our last two teams. So this next group, you know, snacking's a multi-billion dollar category, right? And everybody knows that it's not easy, not an easy category to disrupt. But this group, T-Squares, has a really cool concept in terms of better for you snacking as a disruptor. T-Squares is on a mission to bring healthy snacking to the world through caffeinated energy bars made with organic tea. One of the things I like about these guys is their vision is to fuel economic development here by manufacturing their snacks and hiring employees within low-income communities to grow their business. So it's really kind of a heartfelt, mission-based company. So if you guys can join me in welcoming T-Squares.
So I know it's been a long day for everyone, so you should all have T-Squares on your chair. There's a couple of DCs, so grab some from the neighbor as well and take those home with you. Give you a little bit of extra boost for the evening. So my name is Jordan Buffner. I'm the founder and CEO of T-Squares, which are a line of superfood energy snacks designed to help fuel your passions and to get you through the day. We also have a social mission of fueling economic development in low-income communities, which is something that's really important and dear to my heart with that. And really, starting out, like, I'm on a mission to help fuel you and your aspirations, your passions, everything that you want to achieve in the day. I want to help you get there through healthy snacking, so you have the energy to do more and get more done. So I want you to raise your hand if you feel like you had too much to do this week and not enough time or energy to get it all done. Yeah, pretty much everyone in the room, right? And let's be real, if you are not energized, if you're not feeling like your best, you're not gonna get everything done. And that's why I invented T-Squares. So T-Squares help you get back to 100%. Our crunchy, tasty snacks are absolutely amazing, so try them out now. They're made with great flavors like our acai blueberry, citrus green tea matcha, and vanilla chai. But most importantly, they're actually made with a focused blend of ingredients to help give you focus, clarity, help you stay productive. So they're perfect snack when you need a little bit of a pick-me-up in between meals first thing in the morning to get through the day. And so they're actually, yep, everyone's opening that they are. So why now for our snacks, right? So there's tons of energy bars out there in the market. So we are sitting at a really important intersection. You know, people are connecting more with their minds, their bodies, and as such, the mindfulness and wellness industries are booming like crazy. At the same time, food is becoming extremely important in our lives, and everyone's moving towards cleaner ingredients, simple products, and that also provide a real functional benefit, right? So instead of just eating food for calories, we're looking to see how is this gonna support my health and diet trends? How am I gonna get more energy from the food that I'm eating? So it's actually lifting me up for the day and not putting me down. And this is positioning T-Squares really at the center of these two movements, where we wanna be the go-to snack for mental fuel. When you're having a long day, when you're first waking up in the morning, you need that extra boost to get going, grab T-Squares, snack on these. They'll give you, solve your hunger, and then also give you an energy pick-me-up as well. And we want to be the leader in the mental fuel category. So we're starting with bars. It's a very crowded market, as Ross just mentioned. It's $6.3 billion. But one thing that's really interesting, according to a study from Mintel, about 25% of the people who are actually eating energy bars are doing so for looking for mental energy. And so that's opposed to all the protein bars that are on the market. And there's really not many energy bars out there that are actually driving this benefit of mental focus. And that's why it's leaving and creating a $1.5 billion opportunity for snacks like us in this category. And there's just a few other players are just starting out, but really we see ourselves being the leader in this category with a great tasting product with the functional benefits to it. At the same time, we've been recognized as thought leaders in this space. We received the Forbes 30 Under 30 Award, participated in Chobani's incubator program, graduated from the Good Food Business Accelerator, and you're also on the board of Naturally Chicago, which is really positioning us to be the kind of leading influencers in this space, in the food community and beyond. One thing that's really unique and differentiated about how we're getting to market is our approach. So for most, if you think of, you know, energy bar, granola bar, you think selling the grocery store. But that's not where most people are experiencing the need. When you need a bar, you're on the go, you're at work, and you need that pick-me-up. So we're actually reaching customers at what we call our points of energy. Corporate offices, universities, airports, fitness studios, the places where you need that pick-me-up, that's the market that we're targeting, and we've developed a unique sales channel in those locations. And second, as we are expanding, we're really pushing our e-commerce sales and finding a lot of customers who are finding us online. It's interesting, people are scrolling on Instagram because they're, you know, bored of what they're doing that day, and they're like, crap, I do need to get back to what I'm doing. They're seeing T-squares, and they're actually coming to our site and converting that way. So we have a large presence of customers who are buying us on e-commerce. And then as we grow, our third phase is really then expanding to grocery in a few years in a really national push to become, you know, to recognize the full revenue opportunity of the brand and really get in front of more eyes. But right now we're focused on our points of energy and e-commerce. And this strategy has worked. So over the last year, we've seen a 10-time growth in our quarterly sales. It's been amazing. And not only that, we're on track to do about $350,000 in sales by the end of the year. Next year, do about $500,000 and continue to grow from there. And we're seeing a strong driver from these channels to really become the leader in that space. So where are we at now? We're currently selling to in about 350 points of distribution. So we're in Farmer's Fridge, Yelp's offices, Braintree. We are selling at Whole Foods and Jewel on the grocery side, Nike, Lyft. So all the tech offices who are actually buying our snacks, providing them, they provide them for free to their employees in the break rooms. And so we have a captive audience. They're getting to try our product, and they're being purchased by these large offices. And it's been amazing to really help provide both a sales and marketing push. Then our target distribution list. We're currently in talks with Google's Silicon Valley office, and that would be about a $250,000 account on its own. Microsoft, Facebook, Dropbox, Starbucks, Twitter, Sony Productions. Half of them on the right are actually signed up. We're getting ready to work with one of our distributors out there, UNFI, to launch on the West Coast. And so half of those companies are already lined up as new customers. Then on e-commerce, we really developed a strong niche on Amazon as well. So we're seeing about 37% average monthly growth, which is huge. We developed that expertise on Amazon to really reach the right customer, have a great conversion rate, and we're listed as Amazon's choice and also on Amazon's launch page, Launchpad, which highlights up-and-coming and rising food brands and provides that and promotes it to their audience. So this has been really successful for us, and we see a continued growth on Amazon as well. So who's actually buying and eating T-squares? People are eating them for morning energy, afternoon pick-me-up, and for exercise recovery. So throughout the entire day, it's not just a breakfast snack. Really, it's that go-to in-between meal snack. You just need a little bit of a pick-me-up. And this is one of our customers, Morgan. She actually works at Braintree, owned by PayPal, and they're one of our first office customers. And she loves snacking on T-squares at 2 or 3 in the afternoon when her energy levels are starting to fade and her to-do list is still full. T-squares helps to give her the energy to get through the day and to keep going. And that's what we do for our thousands of customers out there. Our team, we've developed a great team with expertise across sales, marketing, operations, branding, and we have this wide assortment of skills to make sure that we have the entire industry covered. And we've also developed a great set of advisors who are supplementing our experience in the food industry and kind of without, so that we have the right partners to grow with. So the social mission behind our company is really important. I'm born and raised here in Chicago on the south side of the city. My mom grew up in the Inglewood community. And when I went off to college and came back and went to start a business, it was really important that I do so in a way that can help out my community that I grew up in as well. And so one thing my dad always taught me was to, when you run your own business, you should be able to take care of yourself, your company, but also your larger community. And I've really taken that to heart. And so we actually located our production facility in the greater Inglewood area, right off 75th and Dan Ryan. Anyone who wants to come by can. And we manufacture all of T-squares there out of a relatively small footprint, but we're able to sell nationwide from that location. And we also hire locally from the community as well. So we have 5 employees that work for us on the production side that are making T-squares day in, day out. And the people that we're working with, we're partnering with organizations, one's called Dovetail, the other is Growing Home, and comes with individuals who come from rough situations. So one of the organizations works with individuals who were previously incarcerated who go through a job training program and are looking for, you know, opportunity to get back into the society. On the other side, Dovetail works with single fathers who have kids, some of them, you know, multiple kids, and they want to be able to provide for their family. They're ready to work, they're ready to make money, but a lot of companies won't give them the opportunity. And we bring those individuals in, provide training for, with our facility, and provide a living wage for them. And so that's been extremely important. And just one quick story on that, one of our members, who's one of our team members a couple years ago, he grew up in Inglewood, smart kid, not involved in any gangs. He was actually driving down the street one day with his friends, like most high schoolers do, and his car was shot 7 times. Luckily, no one was hurt, but it really speaks to these kids, these individuals need another avenue to be at, so they're not just outside in danger in a lot of these communities, and we help to provide that. So one of our keys to success is really offering a differentiated product to market with our unique kind of focused blend of ingredients with T-Squares. We also have a pioneering go-to-market strategy where we are working with these corporate offices to get T-Squares into the hands of our customers when and where they need it. And we also have an authentic brand story. So being from Chicago, we really share that dual mission of helping everyone here and our entire customer base fuel their passions and their life, while also helping to support the aspirations of the employees that we hire as well. We really see this as a winning category or combination to help T-Squares really grow. Now, we could really benefit from help from Q Labs because we have this great story, our customers love it, but we really need to communicate that better. And so understanding how to best tell that story, how to use video and marketing techniques to get in front of more customers so they can understand what we do, why we do it, and the mission behind there. So I'm really on the mission to believe that everyone should have the energy to really achieve your dreams and your best life. And we want T-Squares to be even just a little part of that journey and helping you achieve your aspirations as well. Thank you.
Outstanding job. Who wants to go first?
Hi, great job. I've seen you before, and I know you have a lot of fans that have tried and used your product in offices, et cetera, so that's great. I was just curious, you had a slide up there that I thought captured the competition in the space. We all know it's crowded, but you said you're in a specific space. Who else is in that specific space, in a snack bar in Mental Fuel?
Yeah, so we're drawing customers larger from people who are eating like protein bars, Kind bars, Luna bars. Those are a large competition. There's another coffee company called Eat Your Coffee that has a coffee-infused bar. They're based in the Boston area. And so there's a couple kind of smaller ones rising up like that. But we actually have worked together with some of those other companies in this space as well because there's such a huge opportunity that we can all benefit.
My question is, how do you plan to scale the workforce aspect of your business model? So really incredible mission, super important that when businesses are growing, they think about giving back to that community. That's been a huge, it's in the news right now a lot, right? How will you scale that? Will you seek out local, figure out where communities are in need elsewhere in the country? Will you stay in Chicago and build that up?
Yeah, definitely. So one of my tenets is I want to not just provide kind of blue-collar jobs, but also help to train white-collar jobs as well. And so we're looking at different options of scaling. We'll probably always keep our own facility at some capacity, but we also might need to work with other manufacturers as we grow. But what I'll always include are fellowship programs, job training programs to bring people in from these communities to help with marketing, operations, sales, and learn from those programs with us as we grow. So we actually host a fellowship program every year for high school students. So this summer we had 2 high school students, one of them focused on sales and marketing from the local community. And so even as we grow, that component of giving back will always be included. It might change a little bit, but they'll always be there in some form.
Great job with the product. Tastes amazing. Curious what some of the adjacent, you know, product lines are that, that you're going to be expanding to in the future. You've obviously done a great job focusing now, but curious what your aspirations are.
Yeah, we have a couple in the works I can't talk about yet, but we, and I believe in helping to fuel your potential and your energy level. So anything that has to do with energy levels, anything that has to do with the right, delivering the right nutrition at the right time. So it could be other bars with different functional benefits, other categories that are adjacent as well that we're looking into as well. So definitely larger than just the bar space.
One, would there be, piggybacking off of that, would there be a caffeine-free version of T-Squares? And then the other is, you talk about energy points. Is there any barrier to entry in the educational field?
Yeah, so when you say educational, do you
mean like schools, just being in schools in general?
Yeah, so we have a lot of customers that are asking us for a caffeine-free version, and we're actually working on that with some other superfoods that are known to help provide energy boosts as well, so yes. And on the educational side, we have a number of customers that say like, oh, these would be great for kids, they're light, they're crunchy. I think with the tea and our products all have nuts in them, they don't fit into like an elementary school kind of bag all the time. But we have a lot of like high school age students that will actually eat tea squares. Their parents like them eating these over a Red Bull or Monster. It's like naturally giving energy.
Great, great product. Also, I am one of those office consumers. We have them in the office, so love the product, eat it every day, it's great. Curious, it looks like when you're thinking about kind of selling to big tech enterprise customers, how that compresses margins at all. So, you know, where are margins today? And then as you're thinking of leveraging that sales pipeline, you know, how do margins compress?
Yeah, so actually we have a better margin selling to the corporate offices than we do at grocery. So our margin average is about 65% for the offices that we work with, e-commerce close to 55 and grocery 45. And so it's actually more beneficial selling to those companies right now. But then I think as we grow, then there's a lot more volume on the grocery side, even though it's at a lower margin.
Great, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm going to ask one, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So I was looking at the product and I noticed it's 100 calories, it's low sugar, 4 grams of protein. I can't help but to think that there's a diet play in this, like because it's super low calorie. Are you guys expanding into, hey, what if we had a relationship with Weight Watchers? Or I'm just wondering because I was really surprised how low the calorie level was.
Yeah, I think that's definitely a really great idea of working with different diets. One thing that I've been kind of found looking in the food space now is diets are becoming very personalized and everyone's looking for something a little different. And so we make sure the state, the calories, the sugar content, the protein content, so that it attracts, you know, there's something for everyone in there, but we don't kind of align ourselves to just one particular diet at this point. But I think there are partnerships. We are on the Weight Watchers app. If
anyone wants to work on it. Okay, good. All right, good job. So our last person is really capitalizing on the bespoke movement, which is growing. I think the opportunity to capitalize that in fashion represents a very big opportunity. So Balodana? Balodana?
Dang it.
I had to get one wrong. I apologize. Is here. They're carving out a design-centric niche with their unique bespoke women's apparel. So it's all yours.
Thanks. So I'm going to assume that.
Yeah.
Okay. Hopefully the sound will work. The sound.
I'm Dana Todd, the founder of Balodana. Balodana is an online department store where every single item is made on demand precisely to your body measurements, so they're guaranteed to fit. We offer everything from underwear to evening wear. And we make it happen by providing a platform that connects women to custom clothing makers worldwide. I want to help every woman in America feel like I did when I got my first made-to-measure garment. I was so pleased with the fit, the quality, and the design. I got compliments, and I turned heads, even though I'm a middle-aged lady with a not-perfect body. And judging by the feedback we get from our customers, I know that I'm not alone in the confidence boost I felt. To build this business, I'm harnessing more than 20 years of experience in marketing and developing digital products. It started when I was at a career crossroads, and simultaneously I was frustrated with trying to find clothes to fit. When I realized I had the concept for my third company, pow, my head exploded. I felt incredible joy, and I was literally jumping up and down like a kid. There's a deep purpose behind what I'm doing. Balladana is helping small makers reach new customers and grow their businesses, and we really care about their futures. Our business model itself ensures that most of the price tag goes directly to the maker, not a markup, so they can provide better workplaces and also higher quality garments to our customers. We manufacture on demand, so it's more sustainable and it's better for the planet. Ladies, I know how much wasted time goes into your current shopping experience. No matter what your age or body shape, you won't believe how you feel in custom clothes, and you will never want to buy anything off the rack again. It's so easy to join the cult of custom and so affordable, you'll wonder why you waited so long.
We're not ambitious at all, right? Let me do a quick show of hands for those ladies out there. Have you ever had trouble finding clothes to fit in the shop? Yes, actually. So you're not alone. The number that we found in our research was it's up to 75% of women say they have some level of frustration trying to find clothes to fit. And that's not just plus size ladies either. That's everybody across the board. Why is it so bad? Why is it so bad? Well, so I was frustrated, and I began digging into this question of why are clothes so terrible right now in the United States? Supposedly, we have way more choice than we ever did before, and all of it is awful. Why is that so? Is it because our supply chain is disconnected from the actual data that the customers provide? Additionally, yes, half of America is over a size 14. There are no standards in measurement or sizing, have you noticed? And also, quality and fabric are affecting the fit as well. So all these things make a terrible experience, but this isn't really the problem, this is the symptom. The real disease is the supply chain itself. The supply chain is deeply broken. We have been now, literally, since the Industrial Revolution, just moving around the same business model all over the world, making it worse and worse and worse. And it essentially rolls up to make, market, and measure. That is, we make some designs and prototypes, we have a 10,000 garment minimum, we shove it out into the market, and then we measure sales, returns, reviews. Did they like it? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know, go back, do it all again. And what ends up now is that, depending on who you ask, the garment industry is somewhere in between the second and fifth largest polluter in the world. There is insane amounts of waste, and it's not just ending up in landfill, it ends up in third world economies, which disrupt their own supply chains. So it is a really devastating thing that we have created for ourselves. But there's a better way, because we can actually go all the way back to the beginning, where things were made one at a time. But with today's technological advancements, we're finally ready to start taking on-demand, custom-made, and with global fulfillment through microfactories all over the world. This is happening right now. And Balladana is taking on the very first step, which is teaching American women how to buy this stuff again. We have literally forgotten. It's been 50 years since any of us really bought things in a custom way, and unless you had a mom who could sew. So what we've done with Balladana is we've created a made-to-measure marketplace, essentially Amazon for made-to-measure. We work with curated number of designers all over the world. We've found 16 so far. We launched with 6, we now have 16. We look specifically for those who have experience doing tailored garments for women via the internet and have been in business long enough that we can trust that we're going to be able to create a satisfactory experience for people. We make it as close to a traditional e-commerce experience as possible. The site looks a lot like a typical site that you'd buy clothing on. The difference is that we have a centralized measurement profile. As you shop, as you buy things, you're filling up your measurement profile, or you can go out and have a full set of them done, and then they're right there when you check out. You just say, use my measurements, and you don't have to worry about it. It becomes much easier. The other piece that's different about it is that we add a services layer. So you think of us as like a Stitch Fix meets Etsy.
So we've got this marketplace, but we also add the style assistance, we add service assistance, we'll even help you get measured. We'll do absolutely everything to streamline that service for you and make it less terrifying. This is our short-term goal right now. Our happiness is guaranteed means that you don't have to worry about sending it back. We'll have it tailored locally at our cost. You're going to be in a low-risk situation for this very surprisingly terrifying new and old thing that we've done. This is my third company, as I said, and I am not from the fashion industry. I'm from the tech industry, and I came from marketing. So this is what I did my whole life. But the one thing I do really, really well is smell an opportunity and also run into fires, into burning buildings. So when I noticed that this is such a chaotic landscape, my spidey senses went insane. And this is ultimately one of the biggest, by the way, is backed up by research. This is the largest, and by the way, not just bespoke, but redoing the entire industry, is actually the largest untapped disruption in the entire planet right now. Major, major ERP companies are looking at this. And we want to be right there in the mix, telling customers how to buy products that they've never bought before. So I have an incredible team. Because I didn't come from fashion, I've recruited pattern makers. I've recruited advisors from the educational side of things. I have a co-founder in addition who does our marketing. We've got financial advisors. So we've had an incredible team come together to support on this. And we're starting to expand. By the way, we just launched our prototype in January. So while I may be the oldest person on this stage, I got the youngest company out here. So the global marketing, the global garment industry is in flux and it is chaos. So those of you who've been in disruption for a while, the best time to jump in is in chaos. Fast tech is evolving rapidly and retail apocalypse continues and will continue. It's not going to get better until it gets much worse. This chaos is sort of a different take on the competition slide. I'd rather show you the new ecosystem, the new landscape of where manufacturing 4.0 is going in this industry. So we're part of this quadrant up here, the new sellers. We partner with the new makers. And we also partner with, license, and resell to our customers, our merchants, fashion tech, which is assistive to help them scale their own businesses. And ultimately, we'll be bringing in partners like the textile revolution for people who are bringing in much more sustainable garments and finding a better way to source these things globally. It's an exciting time to be on the sustainable side of fashion. Balenciaga's marketplace delivers revenue right now, not with an 80% markup, but a complete reverse of that. We take 20% off the top, like all marketplaces. We actually charge more than Amazon, and we charge more than Etsy, but we're delivering more service for it. We don't charge for a listing fee yet. We may have to do that in the future to grow, but for right now, we're making it simple for our merchants to just come in with a flat fee for their hosting and then start paying us more additionally for marketing services. We are launching a new product called the Concierge Club, which gives you a little bit more hands-on, like a Stitch Fix type of thing, where we'll actually create virtual boxes for you, and that will make it drive sales a little bit more easily. We don't carry inventory, so it's an extremely low-risk, low-overhead model. Our market itself, these are our ladies. This is the first, the primary audience. Women over 30, 35 actually have the largest amount of money and the greatest need to buy these things. If we capture just 10% of the market, these 56 million women, we've got $1 billion. Now, stack that with our secondary market, which will be the Gen Zs. They are driven by sustainability and they really want quality now. They're finally figuring out that all this crap they're buying from H&M isn't working and they're looking for an alternative. How we grow, we talked about sales commission. We're growing right now through a lot of experimenting. We're doing social, of course. We've done some fantastic PR. We've been on Fox, NBC, ABC, Technori, I forget, PBS is coming up. We've been doing a lot of press there, and that's really helping to drive the engagement and the awareness right now. And the typical, my background is digital marketing, so digital is what we've been doing a lot of, but we found that we have to get in front of people and do a lot of touching and letting them feel the merchandise. So we're doing a lot more trunk shows and face-to-face type of things and exploring a retail opportunity as well. The expanded revenue stream, so we really want to go over here with this partnerships because we now have over 800 items and it's growing all the time. So these are all made to measure garments. We can license this whole inventory to somebody else. The way our technology is structured, we can just reskin it and push it through another retail partner if they wanted to start offering bespoke offerings themselves. why we're here today. Ladies and gentlemen, I have bootstrapped this thing. 18 months ago, I said, let's do this thing full time. I have put everything into it with my partners. We've sunk our loves, our lives, and everything into this. I've taken it about as far as I can get. My background as a CMO has helped me really be able to keep a lean overhead, but I've taken it as far as I can, and I want to go back to being the CEO. So I need help on the marketing. I definitely need help on the website UI. We designed it when we didn't have any inventory, and it has not grown with us. We really need help with the merchandising piece of that. Additionally, we need creative strategy. We're going out for financing now. So we've taken on a little bit of friends and family, but we're ready to get serious in our fundraising. We gotta look sharp, and we have to have our creative strategy together. And that rolls over then into an ad campaign. We've been focusing only in Chicago right now, testing and making our mistakes small and local. But we need to be able to hit a national campaign with what we know. And then finally, we would really like to, as soon as we get a little bit of money, do an in-store experience. One of our partners is in India, and they are doing gangbusters right now by having one of these kind of stores where you can go in. Think of it as Amazon Go for made to measure. I know I keep referencing Amazon, but really they do it right. So you go in, you see samples on the wall, you can touch them all, you can feel the quality, you can pick up what you want. You've got a large touchscreen interface that interacts with the website when you pick it out. You go into a small size scanner. They're not that expensive. The good ones are about $18,000. You do your full 3D body scan. A tailor's there to double check a few key measurements and make sure it's right. You get your stuff shipped to you sometimes within 7 days. Boom. And the price points for a lot of these are under $100. Astonishing. Yes. So that is my story, and I really hope that you all vote for me today. Oh, can I tell you one more thing about Chicago? So Chicago is the center of all retail innovation. So it appears to me that Chicago is exactly where we should bring this to life again. Thank you.
Who would like to address the first question?
I wanted to have Asha come up too. So Asha is one of our fantastic team members.
Does she want to spin around? And
yeah, she is. Asha's wearing a brand new fall piece from EUG Fashion. They're from Bulgaria. And while you wouldn't think something so loose-fitting and stretchy would need to be made to measure, but there are points, and this wasn't made for her, unfortunately, but you can see, you can cut it, you can measure the length here, you can cut for arms, you can cut for chest and hips. So all of these things, even loose-fitting garments, can be made to measure.
Great, thank you so much. Very engaging, entertaining presentation. Very nice job. My question is two parts. So I understand delivering a high quality product and a strong user experience is, you know, part of this, the value proposition.
Yes.
So how do you ensure, and I know you briefly touched on it, that consumers are measuring themselves appropriately at home to then receive the correct product? And then additionally, how do you manage returns and alterations through the process?
So the first one, we do provide a very comprehensive step-by-step, lots of pictures for them to measure themselves. However, we actually prefer that they go to a local tailor. And one of the things that we launched, we've got it launched here in Chicago and also Atlanta in a secondary market. We've created what we call a local guides partnership with local tailors and alterations people. We have them set up and prepped and ready. They will do a professional workup for you for free. And then we comp them back for any new customers that they bring us. So we'll be expanding that nationally. So that way we can send someone to someone we trust that we know is going to be doing a good job. Secondarily, in terms of returns, one of the frustrations, one of the reasons why I built this instead of Etsy is that we had a lot of inconsistent returns. This person allowed it, this person didn't. It's also terrible for the planet to just be shipping things back over. So we got everyone to agree to a unified returns policy, which is that, A, there really are no returns, but what we can do is, if this is something that just needs to be altered locally, we'll reimburse up to 25% of the garment value. And if it does, if it's just wrong, flat out wrong, then our tailors remake it at their expense. So I don't bear that burden. That actually comes from the merchants themselves.
Thanks. My question is in regards to the actual designers themselves. You said you went from 6 to 16.
Yes.
How long does that process take to actually grab a designer? Because you mentioned sending or giving your database to larger companies. So if you were to need more designers, I'm curious how long something like that would take.
So we're in a luxury luxury spot right now that we are turning away more than we are taking on. So initially we were, scrabbling around on Etsy and asking referrals, and we'll still do a lot of that. We do look for backgrounds online if they've got a substantial amount of experience. But I don't want to grow, I don't want to be Etsy. I don't want to be 1.9 million. But what I do want to have is enough breadth of styles. We went out early and only had the 6 designers. We found very quickly that we were not matching with everybody's perceived styles. So by growing it out to 16, and probably in the next 2 to 3 years, I'd like to see us hit about 50 to 100, because then we'll always want to keep scaling. Some of them are going to be in luxury, some of them are not, but they're only going to be taking on a small number of items per month. Like we have a London-based designer, his stuff's about $2,500 a suit, so he's not going to be taking on a whole lot.
Love the concept. Congratulations on all the progress so far. So apologies for all the detailed questions, but I'm a finance guy at a two-sided marketplace, so I'm going to really try to get down to the details. Do you mind running us through some of your high-level numbers, average order value, transactions to date, revenue, breakage, returns, things
like that? So I can't talk about our in terms of sales and things because we're still pretty new, and also I'm not talking publicly about that. But I can tell you that actually our average order value was higher than we expected. When we were doing our initial forecast, we were thinking, well, it'll be like Stitch Fix, right, about 180 per 6 months or what have you. And we've actually found that our average order value is higher than that. It's coming in about 190 to 200. Plus we also do a fair amount of gift certificates. So this is a whole other market. Gentlemen will buy their ladies some stuff because men are actually much more used to buying custom clothes than women are. So we've found ourselves a little sweet spot there where men will buy their wives and girlfriends. Sold one the other day for $1,000. So that does happen.
Can you see the name of the brand or the designer when you're going through your inventory? And then how do you prevent disintermediation such that if I have a really good experience with one designer, I may just go to their site directly to bypass your take rate?
So quite a number of our merchants already have their own websites, and many of them have Etsy sites as well. So we offer the convenience of having your measurements. That's kind of our whole, that's how we keep you on there. And then that's the other reason why we invented the Concierge Club, because we believe that that'll keep health, that retention. Because if you go on Etsy, or if you go direct to many of these merchants, they don't even speak English very well. So the service levels are quite different. And also our price points are the same as theirs. So there's really not an advantage to going direct to them. It's really much more advantageous for a customer to stay with us.
And last question quickly. I know you mentioned in the future potentially having an in-store experience with a 3D scanner. Have you taken any analogous kind of product features from the men's bespoke side? So like M. Taylor uses photos and AR kit on the iPhone to do the same kind of remote experience. Have you thought about using AR kit or
I've thought remote? and thought. And I've looked and researched and tried and experimented. And to be honest, they're all so close to being just right. But none of them has really gone to the extent that we would need to be able to do like true tailoring. The picture like front side better that do basically AR, those all work great until you start dealing with plus size ladies. We got a lot of curves, and add more, and it just actually throws off the 3D scans to deal with folds and other bits. So for men, yes, there's a lot of things to be learned there, and even a lot of the ladies of bespoke clothing are experimenting with those as well. But I want to tell you that there's a margin of error right now that is going to give me pause to adopt any of it until we get over that hurdle. But we're very close. We are so, so very close right there.
We have time for one more.
I can hear you.
The cameras can.
Yeah.
So.
Can you talk a bit more about the Concierge Club, you called it? What's the concept? What, is there a fee? Do you have stylists? This, lovely fashionable woman, would she be helping me choose clothes? I mean, right. Talk about what that concept is, because to me that's, you have your measurements already in there, that repeat business is probably going to be super important.
Yes, absolutely. So the Concierge Club would be $49.95. That's the current price point that we're working with. We really wanted to make it sub 50 if we can. It's really a break even for us. What we found is that our biggest obstacle right now is getting women to go out and get measured, or to measure themselves, or to get a friend to measure them. It's literally, and it's divided between women who just don't want to look at their measurements, women who are like, yeah, I'm afraid of this whole process because I'm afraid I'm going to mess it up, to your point earlier. And then the third who are just like, I just don't have time. I have, you know, kids, blah, blah, blah. So there's this part of it. So allowing, having them pay into it, into the process for the handholding, allows us to have that relationship automatically. And then we sort of hold them accountable to that. So it's, you know, it's like a reverse psychology rather than just giving it away, charging for the thing that we used to give away. If that makes sense. And then, yes, the styling, the fixes, as it were, ongoing, are a big part of what we do. We do it right now. I actually was just counseling a transgender person yesterday on how to figure out what to wear for something there. So we very much want to be part of that support process for them.
Did you outline your, like, target audience, like income level and age?
Absolutely. Yeah, so it's 35 and older, 50, well, we call it medium to high household income, and depending on which state you're dealing with, that's probably 55 and that's individual income. We are looking for professional women. They're probably, the identifiers that we have psychographically is that they're either strivers or they're already at the top. So. And then there's another piece of this, though, which is that trigger component. So the trigger components are around special occasions right now, typically weddings, you know, something at work, or if you have a special occasion or a party, proms also, and anything related to bridal. So right now, for example, did you know this? There's a whole thing called wedding guest dressing. Because we all live our days in leisure wear, we now, it's like adult prom. So more is spent now for women because it's an opportunity for us to go and dress up. Now that is changing a little bit in that younger demographic that we talked about. Because while younger generation, you know, fashion's cyclical, right? So we just spent 30 years in yoga pants. There are some signals that the younger generation enjoy dressing up and they want to kind of get back to basics, and they're very into quality as the highest mark. That's why they're adopting luxury products, because those are proxies for quality. Mm-hmm.
So a little bit of behavior adaption is necessary.
Very much. Yeah.
And, but really great concept. Let's give them a So judges, up to this moment, you've had it very easy. Just joking. So let's make sure you guys tally up. Make sure you do your ranking from 1, 2, and 3. In between there, I wanted to kind of again really thank all the presenting companies. So if you guys can all come up on stage, let's do a quick group photo. Presenting companies. Thanks, everybody.
Isn't it?
That's what I was telling you.
Was last year.
Yeah.
When you were
spending
at Paris.
Yeah. Oh. See, it might.
There was stress.